Welcome to church!
Well, good morning, everybody. We are so glad that you decided to join us this Palm Sunday.
Yes.
My name is Aislinn Loud, and I'm no stranger to this wonderful house because I'm a senior at Valor Christian College finishing up my pastoral leadership degree.
And my name is David Rambion. I'm a junior here at the School of the Spirit, Valor Christian College, and I get to serve at City Harvest Network. And we are so glad that all of you online family are joining us this Sunday morning. Listen, do us a favor and make sure you're sharing this live to everyone that you know, all your friends, your family members, your coworkers, your neighbors. Let them know that World Harvest Church is live and Dr. Rod Parsley has a word just for you.
Yes, and David, we've already got some people watching.
Yes,
so let's just say good morning to the saints. We got Peggy, she's watching, she's excited. We've got Bonnie, good morning.
We're so glad
you joined us. We're glad that Lucas, you joined us this morning.
Yes.
Continue to comment, continue to share, continue to let us know that you're tuning in. Look, sharing is one of the easiest ways to evangelize, so make sure you are doing just that.
That's right. Easter is right around the corner, Aislinn. We have so many things happening here this coming weekend, starting with our Good Friday Holy Communion service with Dr. Rod Parsley, March 29th. It's going to be an amazing time. But we not only have that service, but we have something for the kiddos as well.
Right. Yes, we do. We have a walk through the Bible, and it is a journey with Jesus. It was so amazing when we did it last year. I was honored to get to serve in Kid Harvest and just watch these kids come crying to the altar because they had just had so much joy and they were weeping because they understood what God did for them and what our Lord and Savior Jesus did for them. It was so powerful. And not only do we have our Holy Communion service on Good Friday, but we also have Resurrection Sunday kicking off on March 31st. It's going to be amazing. David, tell us what we're expecting.
We're going to have Miss Shayna Wilson-Williams joining us in the house. She's family. I can't wait to have her here. Listen, she's going to be leading worship alongside of Harvest Music Live. But not only that, after Sunday service, we got an amazing egg hunt for the whole family and for the kiddos. But we are giving away 40,000 pounds of food just for you. So if you're in the Ohio area, join us for Easter weekend. Listen, we want to be a blessing for you.
Yes, so make sure that you are here if you are able to be. We would love for you to be here.
Come
it's Holy Week. We're excited. We have so much anticipation. And you can find all of these announcements and more at WHC.life. Make sure that you go on and you just catch up and make sure that you are up to date with everything.
That's right. We are so excited. Let us know what you're expecting God to do this Sunday morning because the atmosphere of expectancy is the breeding ground of miracles.
Yes.
I'm ready.
I'm ready too, David. We are going to be kicking off service, so move the coffee table out of the way. Service will begin in 90 seconds.
Well, good morning, World Harvest Church family.
Good morning.
Are y'all ready? Happy Palm Sunday. This
Happy
is the
Palm
beginning
Sunday.
Of Holy Week. Listen, Jesus rode in to Jerusalem on a donkey and he crowned him king. Come on, are y'all excited to crown Jesus king this Sunday morning?
Yes. Today is a day that the Lord has made, so we are going to rejoice and be glad in it, especially because this is Holy Week and we know God is going to do amazing things. Amen.
Yes.
He's going to do amazing things. Yes, amazing. So if everyone is able to stand, go ahead and stand. We're going to enter into a time of praise and worship. Pastor Chris, come on and lead the people in.
Sounds good, kiddos. Happy Sunday, everybody. Father, we thank you for another opportunity to be in your presence, God. And Lord, we're living the good news that you love us. We've come to declare it, to share the good news of the gospel. Here we go. There's a lot of talk going around town. People living in fear and doubt. Every word like an anchor, just bringing them down, down, down. We've all been looking for a silver lining, something to hold on to when holes been hiding. I know a place you can go if you want to find it. Come on, tell them good news.
This is good news.
If you're breathing, it's for you.
An empty grave.
A life that's changed. It all points to Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
If you've been searching, and nothing's been working, tell them I got good news. Tell them, y'all.
Jesus loves you.
Anybody trying to find it?
So open up your eyes and look around. This is a place where your freedom is found. Take a minute, breathe it in, watch it turn your life upside down, yes.
A life that's changed,
it all points to Jesus.
Nothing's been working, then I've got good news. This is good news of the gospel. Say,
Jesus loves you.
So thankful for your love, my God. What amazing love. You grateful for the good news, church? Listen, listen. And no matter what you bring, oh, he's in love with you. No matter your history, listen. Oh, he's in love with you. Y'all remember?
Yes, Jesus loves me. Oh, yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Come on, let's declare that out. Say yes.
Yes, Jesus.
Oh, he's in love.
No matter your history.
people, let's just thank him for his amazing love, the good news of the gospel. Our actions don't change it. Our failures don't change it. He's still in love with us. Are you thankful today, church? Come on, hands up if you're able. Elkhart Campus, everyone online, social media, right here in this room. God, we're just so grateful that you loved us so much that you came, robed yourself in flesh, shed your blood for us, God. Thank you, Father.
I was a leper outside the city. None would come close. You wouldn't let go. What worked back then,
thank you, Lord,
will work again. I know the blood is still blood.
You're thankful today, church?
Yeah. I had an issue no one could help.
This is our story.
I tried them all. My last try, I crawled. What worked back then will work again. I know the blood is still the blood.
Come on, oh how precious.
And oh how precious.
How beautiful. Sing it out, church. This priceless love.
This priceless love.
I've come to know. Thank you, Lord.
I've come to know.
In the midst of.
In the midst of.
Hard times. The darkest
my
storm.
Darkest storm.
I know the blood.
I know the blood. Woo! Is still
aha!
The blood.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Thank you, Lord.
I was just like Mary. Labeled by shame,
my God.
They called my wrong, but you called my name.
Listen,
and one word back then will work again. I know the blood is still the blood. I know the blood is still the blood.
Make me whole. highest mountain still flows to the lowest valley. Woo! We're so grateful. Wow, happy Sunday morning, everybody. You're in a room filled with people that can testify the blood still works. Amen. Amen. All right, well, we're going to shift gears here, and we want to show you that we are the friendliest church in Columbus, Ohio, and we're going to take a minute and do what we call meet and greet. We're going to put 2 minutes up on the clock, and we're going to ask you to get out of your seat, go across the aisle, introduce yourself, tell somebody good morning. Here we go, 2 minutes on the clock. Show yourself friendly. Say hello.
Well, welcome online, welcome. Family. What a time of worship.
Such a powerful time.
God. The blood is still the blood. Listen, yes. Do us a favor and share, and make sure you put on that share, the blood is still the blood. Listen, keep on engaging with us. Listen, we have so many
yes,
people joining
we do.
Us live right now.
Yes, we have Johnny. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood. Amen. We are so grateful. Look, it's Holy Week. We've been so excited because of that. And we are just so grateful for what God did for us, too. We have Praise the Lamb. Kimberly said yes and amen. Yes, praise
and
him.
Amen. Listen, we have Janet Thomas. The blood covers you. Jody, Anna, Ruth.
Amen. Rosie,
listen, comment all the people that you're believing God for for salvation this Sunday. Listen, today is the day of salvation, and the
Amen.
Blood is still the blood. My good God.
Amen. Look, we've got people that say, we have Rose who asked, please pray for my full recovery of a broken leg. Well, in Jesus' name, let you be healed. It's that quick. It's that simple. When we just say his name, healing can come and will come. So say it by faith with us, Rose. We are believing for your healing.
Come on. Keep on giving us these comments. Keep on engaging with us. And let us know from where you're watching. We want to know, because we have people all over the
world.
All
over the world.
All over the world. I know Maria from Toronto is watching right now. Listen,
Hi, Miss Maria. Many
things that are happening here at World Harvest Church. Easter Sunday is coming up. And if you're in the Ohio area, get here. It's going to be an amazing time.
Yes, even if you aren't, we would love for you to go from being online to being right here,
in
especially
person.
Because it's Holy Week. We have Good Friday. We've got Easter. We want you to be able to experience all the great things that God is doing. Look, Palm Sunday today. Yes, and amen. It is Palm Sunday. We're so glad to be celebrating right with you. There is power in the blood. So many are saying power in the blood, and I love it because that's what our song just talked about, how there is so much power in the blood of Jesus. It's the blood that covers us, cleanses us, and sets us free and sets you free.
Come on. Well, listen, we're heading back to the tab. We'll see you soon.
Everyone online, welcome back. God bless you. So glad you're with us. Elkhart Campus, happy Sunday morning! All right, back to your seats, please, here in Columbus, but remain standing. If you had a seat, please stand with us. Again, happy Sunday morning and welcome. Everyone, so glad that you're with us. Help us welcome to this platform, Pastor Rod Parsley.
Good morning! We are moving things along. Thank you, Pastor Chris. Don't you love HML? I said, don't you love HML? We got to move things along because the HPS boys basketball team, for the second year running, well, seventh year regional champions, last year's state runners-up, and today they play in that game again for the state championship. So we got some, and it's serve day. Y'all look so good. Elder Canfield went all cash today. Look at that, got his dream team shirt on. Do you love that man? Miss Deborah George is already here for Easter week. Holy Week. We are so thankful. Boy, y'all were busy yesterday. There was a beautiful lady that just spoke to me in the altar about her six-year-old granddaughter. Where are you? She, come here, hurry. Give her some come on music there, Wendell. And she's got OH on, that's right. Tell these folks your name.
Shay.
Tell them how long you've been coming.
3 years.
3 years. And tell all these folks like you told me what happened yesterday at the bunny breakfast. Now, wait a minute. Come up here, Blair. Run up here. I want you to thank my daughter, the student pastor at the School of Revival, Valor Christian College, and the brain trust and the muscle behind yesterday's amazing bunny breakfast. Listen, y'all gotta learn to register. We had 230 people registered and over 800 showed up. I mean, look at that. You couldn't move in there. We had to open up Bradley Hall. These face painting folks, when we do Masters Welcome Again, yes, we are. When we do it, we want these folks as makeup artists because they were incredible. Pony rides and what was that, petting zoo, all that stuff going on. I want to thank every single member of the service planning team, yes, of the events team, of the children's ministry, every single group that made that. I've never had more people come up, entire families. I met three different families from Cleveland, yes, yes, right? And I met parents, grandparents, children from those families, 10 and 12 of them. The most amazing thing. And tell these folks what you had.
My six-year-old granddaughter said to me, "Gam, thank you so much for introducing us to this church, and I love this church."
6 years old. 6 years. What does that mean to a grandmother?
I loved hearing it, and we told Miss Katie this morning, it's working.
Oh, tell him again, it's working.
It's working.
Tell him again, it's working. Working. Give Jesus a great big hand, because we love kids. I mean, we love kids. What a great day that was. And then, as if that wasn't enough, at Elkhart and Columbus Dream Teamers, we had 46 from Elkhart and Columbus and 13 staff. Thank you, staff, for leading by presence. Going door to door with Peeps, tulips, pizza truck. The Elkhart Food Pantry yesterday gave out, they've given a total. Yesterday they served 5,427 pounds of food for a total this year of 29,858 pounds. We're gonna have 40,000 pounds of fresh, free food out here on Easter Sunday, next Sunday. Let's thank God for that. And yesterday, you all personally invited 10,377 people to church on Easter. This year, we have invited 55,426 people to church. Come on! Woo! Fantastic! Turn around and tell somebody, you look amazing today. And you can be seated. There were these two guys. There were these two guys out on a fishing trip, you know, out in on the ocean in game fishing. You know, they were fishing for big fish. I like to fish for big fish. And a little teeny fish. Big fish. And when you tell the story about your fish, it always grows, doesn't it? How big is that fish? Oh, yeah, about that. And they got stranded on a desert island. They had run completely out of fuel. They ran up against the beach. They got out of their boat, and one of them looked at us. I don't know what we're going to do. He went to gathering wood. He said, "We got to try to build a fire. They're never, ever going to find us out here. Nobody knows we're here." And he looked at his buddy who was lying on the beach getting a suntan. And he said, "Man, you got to get up and help me. We're going to be lost out here." And he looked back up at him, moved his sunshades, and said, don't worry about it. He said, I make $10,000 a week. Well, the guy said, how's that going to help us out here? $10,000 a week. What are we going to do? Use it for a fire? And so he looked back up at the guy in such distress, and he said, you got nothing to worry about. I'm a tither, and that means my tithe is $1,000 a week. My pastor will find us. I believe I'd find you. Amen. Say, I'm a tither. Hallelujah. 10% of the sanctified gross teaching or gross income. Don't forget tomorrow, get online and get signed up for my international teaching letter all Holy Week, Monday through Sunday. Get signed up for that, and you can get those teachings hot off my desk every single day, sent right to your email. 2024 is a year of an 2024 is a year of a, and God said, I will open a door that no man can close. Psalm 24:7, lift up your head, O ye gates, be lifted up, ye everlasting doors, for the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle, Jehovah Issus Hakaboth, the God who has never lost a battle. I dare you to shove somebody next to you and say, my God has never lost a battle. Now, 2024, I'm sharing with you from our 40-day devotional and fasting guide, because we are doing three things, three the perfect number of God. We are fasting, not a hunger strike against God, but to get your flesh in line to receive what God already determined to do for you. He's just getting you in agreement with him, right? So you are a three-part being, just like God. God is a Father, Son, Holy Spirit. You are a spirit, a soul, and a body, in that order. Spirit first, soul, mind, will, emotion second, body third. So just tell your flesh, say, flesh, you're out of line. You may not have the whole coconut pie. You can have a little piece. Don't you talk to yourself. So I believe day 19 is where I pulled this from. And the New Testament reading is 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 10. He who supplies seed to the sower... Not a very good sower with no seed, eh? Supplies seed to the sower and supplies bread for the eating. Please notice that the bread comes after the sowing. I'm going to try again. If anybody knows Jesus over here? I said, first comes the seed, then comes the bread. Sometimes y'all eat your seed and then wonder why you got no bread. You know, Cameron, I can hear you amening me back there. Listen, people are so funny. They're just funny. Hello, Amy. Hello, Toronto. So people say things like this, you know, you got to follow the science, right? Okay, so in following the science, they ask silly questions like, what came first, the
chicken or the egg?
You're very good, Cameron. Cameron is a Columbus TV star, you know. No, like for real, he really is. And Miss Elisa Henry, I saw her, I think last night on Cash Explosion. At Saturday night, and I text her and said, give me some of that money y'all giving away. Amen. So anyway, they say, what came first, the chicken or the egg? So I want all biblical people, which takes precedence over science, I want you to tell me which came first. The chicken. Are you following the science? I'm following the word. God created everything in adult form. Watch, watch. This is your God and mine. With its seed already in it. That's how you get a perpetual harvest, because God supplies a perpetual seed. But a seed cannot multiply in your hand. You can carry your seed around. You can put it in your savings account, in your 401k. It might multiply a little bit, not very much. Not as much as interest rates in the United States are climbing. Who can afford a house at 7.5% interest? 3.5 years ago, it was 2.5. You went to build them with me. So you can put your seed. When my pop passed, my dad, we went and checked our barn. Because my dad was from the old school, right? He didn't trust banks a whole lot. He didn't really trust anybody. And then as he got up in age, his memory started to lapse some. And so we thought, you know, he spent a lot of time in the barn. Maybe. And my mother had a buzzer. You could hear that buzzer like one of those sirens for tornadoes. And you could tell whether she was angry or not. If she's just calling him to dinner, she'd just hit it, beep, like that. But when she's mad, meep, meep. So Dad went to heaven, and we got to thinking, we might ought to go check that barn. So we found a place where you could tell the earth had been moved. So I said, Darren, dig in there. Chunk. He hit a big old toolbox. Darren said, well, he's buried his tools. I said, there ain't no tools in there, bud. Dig that on up out of there. And he had saved for my mother $1,000 a year and put it in that toolbox and forgot that he buried that thing in the barn. Nobody knew about it. We opened that thing up. There was over $50,000 cash. He'd saved $1,000 a year for my mother. We never did tell her. But anyway, your seed doesn't do any good buried in a toolbox in the barn, does it? You have to get it out and sow it. And God said, I'll give you seed for the sowing. There's not a person in here today without a seed. Not a person. Now, there may be seed you're trying to eat or seed you're trying to save or hide. But God said, if you let go of what's in your hand toward me, be a tither, I'm going to make sure you have bread for the eating. Now just close your Bible, whether you opened it or not, and say, God's going to take care of me. I said, God's going to take care of me. And he doesn't do barely getting by either. No, that's not God. God multiplies your seed sown. Hallelujah. Lord God, today as we obey your word, we thank you for the support of your kingdom and for giving us a soul with every dollar and changing people's lives, not only in this world, but the world to come. And we bless you for it in Jesus' mighty name. And all God's people in agreement shouted amen. The methods of giving are on the screen, or they're on your screen right there at home. Do you love our Elkhart campus? Do you love all our City Harvest Network campuses across America, around the world? Do you love everybody watching online on Facebook and YouTube and rodparsley.com and all the rest of it? I can't remember all of it. You don't look like, okay, stop, ushers. Stop. They don't look like cheerful givers. Book said God refuses to do without a cheerful giver. Amen. So don't look at your seed, look at the harvest and get happy. Amen. Here's Pastor Chris.
The cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied, singing glory,
glory to His name.
I am so wondrously saved from sin, Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where He took me, and I'm singing glory,
glory to His name.
Come on, glory to His name, say.
Glory to His name.
Precious name.
Glory to His name.
There to my heart. So rich and sweet, cast thy poor soul at thy Savior's feet. Plunge in today, you'll be made complete. Singing glory to
His name.
Everybody sing glory to
His name.
Precious name. Singing glory.
Glory to His name.
Then to my heart, once the blood upon. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there my faith.
It was there my faith. I received my sight.
And now
I am happy all the day.
It was there my faith.
There my faith.
I received my sight.
My sight.
And now I am happy all the day. One more. There is power, power, wonder working power. You say, of the Lamb. Come on, say there is power, wonder working
power.
My God. One more time and say, power. Yeah. It's in the blood of the Lamb.
Wow. Wow. Father, in Jesus' name, right now,
yes, God.
We just sang your word.
Yes,
there is power.
Yes,
sin eradicating.
Yes.
Power.
Yes.
Demon destroying power.
Yes.
Sickness annihilating power.
Yes.
In the blood of Jesus. So right now, I pray for every person here assembled. Those assembled around the world with us today, many, many hundreds of thousands, oh God, wherever they are, touch them now. Touch them in their spirits to know you, to have an up-to-date relationship, sins forgiven, on their way to heaven with Jesus Christ. Father, we ask you to just quiet and still their minds, their emotions. We just rebuke anxiety. We come against fear. We bind every spirit but the Holy Spirit. We thank you for healing their bodies. Psalm 107, verse 20, you sent your word and healed us and delivered us from all of our destruction. God, we bless you for meeting all our needs according to your riches in glory by Christ Jesus. We thank you for bringing our families into the saving grace of Christ. If they were here with us yesterday, we just pray that next Sunday they'll be right here beside us in church, in love with King Jesus. We just thank you for it. You're so wonderful to us. Amen. Amen. Well, shout, God is good. You may be seated. Grab your Bible, the book of Action. It may say just Acts in your Bible after the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John in the New Testament, first four books of the New Testament. The fifth book is the book of Acts. I call it Action because that's where the God in Christ becomes the Christ in you. And you are no longer just a spectator of Jesus and a fan of the message of the gospel, but you are an everyday, 366 days this year, you are an active participant as a culturally incorrect agent of redemptive change wherever you go. You are that remnant, that relevant, that resurrected church of Jesus Christ against which the gates of hell shall not prevail, and no weapon formed against you shall prosper. And every tongue that rises against you in judgment, you condemn. This is the heritage of the children of the Lord, and our righteousness is of God. So let the redeemed of the Lord shout like it. Amen. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed by his infinite mercy. God's child forever. Doesn't matter what you say about me. God's child forever. Doesn't matter what you write about me. God's child forever. Doesn't matter what you tweet about me. God's child forever and forever and forever I am. And this life is just a vapor seen for a moment and then gone. And so shall we ever be with the Lord forever. So let the storm clouds rise. Let the dark clouds rise. They don't worry me, for I'm sheltered safe within the arms of God. He walks with me, and none of earth can harm me, for I'm sheltered safe within the arms of God. If you believe it all, it was every word from the Bible quoted for you. So thank God for his word. All right, we're going to Acts chapter number 17 and verse 17. This time, I'm going to come to you a little bit out of my latest book. It is blowing up across America, Idolatry in America. If you want to know what's wrong with America, here it is. Idolatry in America. Very first commandment. You shall have no other gods before me. Commandment number two, you shall not make unto you any graven image. Those are the first two. We take you all the way through it in idolatry in America. Are you ready? Acts chapter 17, verse 16. Paul, the apostle's spirit, was stirred in him. Not his mind, his emotions, not his will. His spirit was stirred within him when he saw the city wholly, completely, entirely given to the worship of idols. May God Almighty grant us that it would be so with us today. Number one, we're going to touch on what may very, very well be the number one idolatrous activity in America today. The number one. More so in America than any other nation on earth. I'm going to point it out to you. But in order to do that, I have to give you a biblical purview, a biblical worldview on the subject. Because if we're going to come out of idolatry, there are a whole lot of folks today, maybe in this room, maybe in one of these other great campuses, watching online, you're going to get set free from the greatest idolatry in your life, and you didn't even know you were bound. Oh, you're afraid to clap now, aren't you? Number one, idolatry. I dare to say it's in virtually every pew in this building. I dare to say it's in virtually every home of those listening to me on radio, watching by television or online. The number one idolatry. So let us change our thinking. Romans 12, 1 and 2 says, I beseech you, I beg you, let me plead with you. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God. I mean, you know it's a struggle when the mercy of God gets involved with it. That the mercy of God, by the mercy of God, that you would present your bodies, basest level of your tripart being, a living sacrifice, and be not conformed or made like, conformed to this world, but be you transformed or differently made than the world. And he's talking here about the world system, the world view, the world structure, the world's way of doing things. You with me so far? Because watch me, everything in the kingdom of God of which you are now hopefully a part. Okay, I got 3 weeks, I think so. You're in one kingdom or the other. There's no gray area. You're either in the kingdom of this world in your thinking, or you're in the kingdom of our God and of his Christ in your thinking. Be not conformed or made like the way they think, but be differently made than they think and therefore do, by, I'm still in Romans 12, 1 and 2, by, look at all you Bible scholars, by the renewing, that means something that you know has to be replaced with what you don't know. Put your hand up there on your temple and say, I need deprogrammed and reprogrammed by the word, which is living and life-giving. Let me give you a PRP translation. You ready? You got to change your stinking thinking. Because the book said, and the book is right and they are wrong, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. So he's saying, by the renewing of your mind in the Word of God, because as you're renewing, it takes that 18-inch drop out of your mind, through your eye gate, through your ear gate, gets deposited in the fertile soil of your human spirit. There, it goes through the process of death, meaning death to your way and life to God's way, and then springs forth to life. You remember what I said about the Word? Or about a seed? Jesus said, the word is the seed. The sower goes forth to sow the word. Some falls on three kinds of ground that don't prosper. But the fourth kind of ground, fertile soil, it grows, goes through death, grows and bears much fruit. You with me so far? So let me help you adjust. Everybody wants to do what Jesus did. Follow the teachings of Jesus, yes? The problem is you don't ever hear the teachings of Jesus, so you let people tell you what the teachings of Jesus are and intimidate you. But not us. We know the difference. The book says his sheep know his voice, and another voice they will not hear. So what's his voice? That book. All right. So if you studied that book as I have for over 60 years, if you've studied that book, you'll find that in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Jesus spoke more about love than any other subject. Number two, he spoke about immorality. No. He spoke about lying. No. Cheating. No. Sin. No. Second only to love, Jesus spoke about your finances. But let a preacher say the word money, and everybody gets just as quiet. Although 50% of Christian and worldly marriages still in America end in divorce. And over 80% of them give as the reason money. So if you get your money straightened out, seems to me like 80% of people could get their marriages straightened out. And then we wouldn't have lonely little leaguers and cheerless cheerleaders. Because mom and dad can't get it together. There are 500 verses in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John on prayer. That's good. Be good to know all of them, right? There are over 2,000 verses that directly deal with your finances. 50% of all of Jesus' teaching dealt specifically with your finances, and 2/3 of the parables that Jesus taught dealt specifically with your finances. So stop following people on the internet that would ridicule a person for speaking to the church about money. You know what I would do if I was the devil? I'd keep you so poor that you couldn't finance the preaching of the gospel around the world, that you couldn't give away 100,000 pounds of food at a time, that you couldn't free 50,000 slaves from human slavery in Sudan, that you couldn't take 5 million pounds of medical supplies to Africa. That's what I'd do. I wouldn't let you be able to print a tract. I wouldn't let you be able to buy a minute of television airtime. I'd keep you so poor you didn't have gas to get to church and were too lazy to walk. Be seated. Now, for those of you that may be a little bit new, I take a couple of messages a year, especially leading into Easter, and speak on this subject. I really should speak about it once a month. It's that prevalent of a need. All right, so let's dive into it. You ready? The 1% mentality. To attain a spot in the top 1% of income earners, say, I'm headed there. You have what you say. You say, I'm headed there. Don't be acting like you don't want to make more money. You've complained all week about the amount of money you make. Then you come in here and get your halo all crooked on your horns and dummy up. If you think you should make more money, shout now. What I thought. So don't be getting in here and get all religious. I'll pull down your religious idol. Because the idolatry that's prevalent in America is money. And it does not matter what tax bracket you end up in. Doesn't matter how much money you've got. I've seen people on government assistance that were just as mean as a striped snake and sticking their hand out demanding more. I've seen people with money that curse the God that gave it to them. Come on now. So to be in the top 1%, you'd have to make how much money? $597,817 a year. Or you would need to have a net worth of $11.1 million. That means all your assets combined. The problem is most of the church owes in debt more than they own, meaning if they got rid of everything they've got, they couldn't pay themselves out of debt. That's where America and its politicians want to keep you, dependent on them. of the wage earners in America don't have that amount of income or assets. America exceeds the world in excess. Today, our nation and its citizens are rolling in excess, reveling in luxury, revolting in morals, and rotting in sin. Just consider for a moment our national obsession with money. It doesn't matter what bracket you're in. Idolatrous worship of money was summed up by Malcolm Forbes, a billionaire who childishly said, "He who dies with the most toys wins." While the Israelites were camped at Mount Sinai awaiting Moses' return from his conference with Almighty God, where Moses was given the Ten Commandments, the first being, "Have no other gods before me," they became bored. They became distracted because they didn't have a cell phone to play with, and they didn't have an iPad, and they didn't have a television, and they didn't have a sports event every 5 minutes. Moses had disappeared into the apex of that mountain in a cloud. His private encounter with God, watch me, lasted 40 days. That's why at this time of year, we fast 40 days. There was lightning and there was thunder. There was clamor and there was shaking and quaking like no one had ever seen on the earth before. The people naturally assumed Moses must have gone up in there and gotten bit by a snake or something and died. They didn't know. So one of them looked back over their shoulder and surmised that they might just as well head back to their slavery in Egypt and forget their arduous journey out into an uncertain future. But they needed a leader. So the congregation got together, took a vote. You always know times are bad whenever the congregation votes. And so their vote came up that Moses' brother Aaron should lead them. His first act as the leader of the nation was to take all the gold that God had put on them when he released them out of Egypt. Watch me, take the gold, Just say money. Take the money, melt it down, and make a mold of a golden calf. That calf began to be worshipped with reckless abandon, hedonism, drunkenness, debauchery, depravity, and sexual perversion. Does it sound familiar? What do Americans do with their money? Let me destroy a major idol and untruth. You ready? Here it is. It's this: that the Bible teaches that money is intrinsically evil. And the more a person has of it, the more evil they must be. There are always those in the church, outside the church, who will confidently affirm the Bible says so. Chapter and verse, please. I need a chapter. I need a verse. I don't need what somebody made up. I need something out of here. You with me? That's what I need. Here is, in fact, what the Bible does say. 1 Timothy 6:10. The love of money is the root of all evil. Now, that's where they get this twisted, unscriptural, ungodly resistance to money from. Well, sex is evil. Don't you married couples have some? You better stop. I said married. I didn't say shacking. Now I've gone to meddling. Sorry, not sorry. Okay, here. Watch what it says. It says the love of money. You know why? Because the first commandment is you shall have no love before me, God. The love of money is the root, didn't say the fruit, of all evil. I will agree. While coveting shall coveting, we'll get to that, after money, some have strayed from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. But the Bible says that God makes rich and adds no sorrow with it. So it's all about the love and the covetousness. Okay, are you getting this? Are you okay? Because I'm giving you a lot of ammunition against your family and friends. Money is not evil. Money is benign. Money is neither good nor evil. All money is a method of exchange whereby we acquire necessary and desired goods and services. That's all money is. Ask yourself this question. If money is so evil, how come you spending so much time trying to get it? Not a one of you believe money's evil. But you slide over depending on amount. Well, that's too much. Well, you say that's too much for them. Would you say that's too much for you? No, you wouldn't. Note that the ways in which money is used can certainly be good or evil, but the actual money itself is 100% neutral. However, the love of money, that's another matter altogether. Hugh Martin said this, if a man's religion does not affect his use of money, that man's religion is in vain. Now that makes a lot of sense. As believers, we made a commitment to worship and serve the one true and living God above everything else. Anything that we love more than or put ahead of God is an idol. Some people put relationships ahead of God. That's an idol. Some people put money ahead of God. That's an idol. Some people put pleasure ahead of God. That's an idol. Some people put wealth ahead of God. That's an idol. I'm going to kill one more verifiably false myth. You ready? I'm going to go quick. It's that churchgoers say that the Bible condemns wealth. The Bible, again, says no such thing. But God's word certainly does condemn covetousness. So what is covetousness? Covetousness is an excessive desire for wealth or possession. That's covetousness. It's even further than that. Covetousness involves others. I want what you've got. Watch now, because I'm going to step on some of your political toes. I want what the government's got. I'm owed it. I have a right. Really? I thought you were dead. Oh, you're not all the way dead. You dead, but right about here. Or right about here. We've all known people that are terribly covetous. You know how you know they're covetous? They criticize what you have that they don't. I've never seen anybody that has criticized somebody that doesn't. Boy, you got around, get around folks ain't got nothing, and watch how quick it takes them to criticize everybody that's got this much more than them. You're a devil. You're a devil. You ought to be rejoicing with everybody. Because the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. It's not about you, it's about the gospel. Now, don't make any mistake about it. Money can become a burden and not a blessing. Because one reason folks don't have more, I believe this, is personal, is because of the way they steward what they do have. Does that make sense? They get X. I've seen people. I've given people cars. Lots of them, as a matter of fact. But a few in this category. Now, I don't know about you, but whatever God gives me, I take care of. You got one set of sheets? Wash them. You You got 25 yards of carpet in your house? Sweep it. I've given people cars in pristine condition, look at them a month later, and be almost ashamed that I gave it to them, wonder if I made a mistake. Filthy, dirty, full of French fries. I'm not playing. Don't you think that's how God feels? You keep asking me for strength. I bless you with strength, but you can't get to church. I bless you with a new car. You drive it to the movie and the ball game, but you don't fill it up with people and bring them to church. I'm just saying. I bless you with health, but you're too busy on Saturday to help us go invite folks to church. Oh, that got real quiet. I'm not condemning you. I'm just trying to get your head on straight. You need to get my book. Living in an upside down world. Everything's upside down. We get angry at the things we should get glad about. Watch this. Wealthy people are not intrinsically evil. Stop. Gathers whoever, that's not right, but whoever gathers, there it is. Dishonest money dwindles away, but whoever gathers money little by little makes it grow. Wow. It's been said money's a good servant. And everybody that paid for your lunch this week ought to shout amen. That you didn't go hungry. Everybody that put your head on a pillow last night ought to shout amen. That you got a bed to sleep in. Everybody that's got a refrigerator ought to shout. Because if you do, you're in the top 80% of the wealthiest people on this planet. Stop acting like wealth is a sin when you're enjoying the wealthiest nation in the world. Money's a poor master. Money will buy you a house, but it can't make it a home. It can purchase sex on the internet in your bedroom while your wife's in there making you dinner, but it won't buy you love. I think the Beatles sang that. Can't buy you love. Everybody tells you so. Can't buy me love. Money can get you an alarm system. They're about $3 a piece now. They sure won't make you secure. Buy you medicine. Won't make you well. Buy you a bed for you to toss and turn in all night long and find no sleep. It can provide every necessity of life, but it can do absolutely nothing about your eternity. Millions and millions of people have legitimately amassed great wealth as a result of hard work. That's a good place to start. I never saw a man make good in life who couldn't get out of bed. Millions of people have become very wealthy through investing. I say that there are many years that I give more than I make. And people look at me like that's impossible. Well, no, you just don't know anything about investing. You've never had a windfall because of wisdom. You didn't bother to learn. You'd rather complain. Millions of people that become idols to a lot of church folk made their wealth with great creativity. They're creative. And that gets rewarded. And then they get, you know, 20 million followers, some of which are you. Right? Talent, ingenuity, innovation, hard work, brilliance, creativity. But there are a whole lot of people, millions and millions, who made great wealth by simply being obedient to the instructions of God in His Word. Romans 1:25 says, don't ever worship and serve the things rather than the God who made the things. Don't ever place more value on temporal things than eternal ones. This is without a doubt the number one form of blatant idolatry in America. So let me ask us, how much of the wealth that God brings into your life do you use on yourself? And how much do you use on others or service to God's kingdom? Self-sacrifice is entry-level Christianity. Malachi 3, bring all the tithe, 10% of the sanctified gross income into the work of God, into the house of God. Then Moedim, three times a year, at Passover or Easter, at Pentecost, and at Tabernacles, in those seasons every year, God says, come before me and I will meet with you, but do not appear before me empty-handed. That's an offering. Malachi said, you've robbed me in tithe and offering. Malachi 3 also says it's the offerings of old that he's specifically talking about, the Moedim, the three times a year that we're to appear before God with something in our hand. This year, Professor Sams, is a year of double Adar. This is a leap year to you. That's why the devotional has 366 devotionals this year, because it's a leap year. For the Jewish people whose calendar works by the moon and not like we who have a Gregorian calendar that works by the sun, in God's calendar, we're in a Moedim right now. We are in Passover. Now, an Adar is a time of optimum sowing for optimum sowing of seed. That's what Adar means. That's the season we're in right now. If you don't believe that, how many of the crops sown in America do you think are sown this time of year across America? Over 90%. The only thing outside of it is winter wheat, which is one of the smallest crops in America. Isn't it interesting that in God's world of sowing and reaping, you sow in the spring? Hallelujah. Jesus, we celebrate next Sunday that God sowed him. We celebrate that too on Good Friday, because God needed a family, so he sowed a son. The Bible calls him the seed, and we are the fruit. God chose this time to sow and called it a time of optimum fertility for sowing of seed. Now, I hope the children are in children's church. a woman has something called a cycle every 28 days. Eggs not fertilized are cast from the body, right? If no seed reaches one of those eggs to fertilize it at the optimum time. Now, if you ever get married and your wife wants children, you will learn this. You will get called at work. You need to come home now. So for all you folk, you know, that want everybody to believe, well, we only did it once, but boy, you hit the jackpot. I mean, you hit the right 36 hours in there, I promise you that. Because there is a time in the cycle that is optimum to sow seed. All in the natural world, same in the spirit. God said at Easter to me, 39 years ago, I was 28 years old, sitting in a bachelor apartment in a broken down recliner with a TV tray as a desk and nothing. And God invaded that space and he said to me, every year at Easter, you celebrate when I, God, gave my best, my only begotten son, to redeem the world from sin, sickness, and poverty. All year long, those of you who are Bible-believing Christians and have the revelation, sow your tithe, 10%. God gives you 100%. Well, I earned it. Well, how could you earn it without him? Because if he doesn't breathe out, you don't breathe in. So he gives it to you. And then he says, I would appreciate 10% of it back to support my kingdom. That's a tithe. And God said, you do that all year long. You give back 10 and you live on 90. And then God said this one time every year during Moedim, during Passover at Easter, I want you to challenge, 39 years ago, I want you to challenge my people to give their very best that one time every year. And for 39 years, God has been faithful to that word. So I encourage you, we begin a 40-day fast. We got 7 days left of that. Then we've got, we've got Good Friday service, Holy Communion service at 7. And many, many of the church sow then, because that's when God sowed, you know, and we're celebrating that God gave his son. Many wait until Easter Sunday morning and they sow. Their resurrection seed and believe God for miracles with that seed. So I'm believing for everybody to give your very best. Now, for 39 years, almost everybody has given the equivalent of 1 week's increase because that was the original word 39 years ago. And God blessed it. God blessed it. Again, I was 28. We needed to build an office building. It was going to cost $100,000. It might as well have been $10 million. And I told that little church, and they went to believe in God. They got extra jobs. They had bake sales. They washed cars. They did everything to get their seed. It wasn't just, well, what can I do? They got busy. They got their seed, and they came and sowed it. And the news media was there that day, all three stations, I believe, ABC, NBC, CBS at the time. And they were down front with cameras right in the altar, and I thought, look at this. God's blessed us with new cameras. And then I saw CBS, ABC. So they started to leave before the service was over. I said, no, wait a minute. Ushers, just help them find them a seat back there, because there weren't any. I said, find them a seat back there. Y'all just stay, and I'll let you know whether God was faithful to his word or not. As my knees went, and I preached and gave the altar call, and here came Mary Cunningham with a little slip of paper. And they had counted that offering and brought it back in, and the newsmen stood up. I said, all right, everybody get ready. My sister, you know, my sister was kind of ornery. She's in heaven now, of course. God gave her a mighty, mighty healing. Given 3 months to live, sent home to die, and God let her live another 30-plus years. I read that little slip of paper. It wasn't 100,000. I'm not talking about pledges. I don't believe in pledges. God doesn't ask for what you don't have, just for what you squeeze with your hand. Anyway, wasn't 100, wasn't 110. We had 100% participation. That was our church at the time. That's the 1,200-seat building over at Wright Road. That's my mother. And this fellow sitting on this end is sitting on the front row this morning. And he always is, Elder Canfield. And he's been with us all these years. You participated in the very first one 39 years ago. Did God bless it? He gave us $147,000 cash that day. Now that says 144, and people want to make me out a liar when I say 147. We did the quick count, and it ended up 144, but then when they recounted it, it ended up 147 something. So anyway, that's what God did 39 years ago. And I believe he's going to do the same for you. Father, bless everybody. Bless everybody, oh God, in the way they need it most. Let us receive your blessing and use it to build your kingdom, to bless the world. In the mighty name of Jesus, I believe for it. Amen. 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 Now, stay right where you are, because it is exactly 11:28. And we're going to keep you here till noon regardless. No, that's not true. That's not true. But we do have, I did cut in on the announcements. And they are very, 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 very important.
Yes, sir.
Because it's Holy Week.
That's right.
We're going to be praying.
Yes.
We're going to be fasting.
Yes.
And we're going to be gathering our seed.
Amen.
And we got Good Friday and for all the children and Easter Sunday.
Right.
Going to be a thing.
That's right.
Amen. Hey, amen. The Sunday after Easter, you can tell I'm excited. The Sunday after Easter, how many of you have heard about the eclipse that's coming on the 8th, right? Entire towns are nervous in the path of this thing because they're going to run out of water. They're expecting millions and millions and millions of people at these sites. It is a phenomenon. It is tied to an eclipse in 1776. There are two eclipses that traced across America, one of which includes this one. One of them crossed over seven cities, all seven called Salem. This one is passing over seven cities called Nineveh. And I'm going to preach about it the Sunday after Easter, signs in the sky. So don't miss it, and bring a bunch of your friends because they're all curious about it. I like to let the devil gather the crowd and then move in on them.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Hey, I love you. Whoever's doing announcements is coming to do it.
Yes, sir.
Aston Blair, you're coming and joining me. Here we go. Here we go.
All right.
I got to get to Dayton.
Yeah.
Get out of here, Matthew. You're going to be here Easter anyway. Stay right where you are and enjoy these beautiful young people. They're going to tell you everything going on.
Light. Right.
And the Warriors win today.
Woo! All right. Yes, Warriors. Woo. Well, we are so glad for the ministry of our pastor, yes. Dr. Rod Parsley, who is glad that we were able to hear just another great word from him. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, David, why don't you tell the people how they can get connected today?
Listen, if you're here in the building for the first time or the first time in a long time, we want to connect with you. And the easiest way to do so is by grabbing the connect card that's in the seat back pocket in front of you. Go ahead and fill that out and make sure you let us know where you heard about the Harv. And on the 4 years, you can give that to one of our dream team members. Dream team!
Woo, 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 woo. Yes, you can do just that. We want to get connected because we are a church that you are family once you've been here one time. Right. We also have some really exciting things coming up. As you know, this is Holy Week. So if you could turn your attention to the screen.
This Easter, we want to invite you to experience the faith,
to embrace the hope,
and encounter the love of the resurrection at World Harvest Church.
It all begins Good Friday night at 7 p.m. with our Holy Communion service,
as we honor and remember the greatest sacrifice.
And children will be going on an immersive journey with Jesus as they walk through the moments that changed the world.
Then Sunday morning at 10 a.m., be uplifted with Harvest Music Live and special guest Shana Wilson-Williams through praise and worship.
And a powerful life-changing word from Pastor Rod Parsley.
Kids will also jump into the Great Egg Scape.
There's going to be an outdoor egg hunt, escape room games, giveaways, and an awesome message just for us.
Plus, we'll be blessing the community with 40,000 pounds of free groceries.
So call the grandparents.
Round up the kids.
Invite the neighbors.
Because there's no weekend like Easter weekend at World Harvest Church.
Good Friday, March 29th at 7 p.m., Easter Sunday, 10 a.m.
For more information, visit whhc.life.
Who is excited for Easter weekend? It's going to be amazing, and we want to make sure that you are able to invite families, invite your friends, invite a stranger that you see at the store, whatever it may be. We have tools for you. Who remembers Be My Peep from last year? Yes, maybe. Okay, well, we're doing it again. So you can give someone a box of peeps and it'll say, Be My Peep for this Easter weekend. We want you to use that tool. Bring your one this Easter Sunday.
Listen, we have so many outreach opportunities. We have Miss Deborah George joining us this week. But listen, make sure you register for our outreach opportunities at whc.life or just come here in the tab on Saturday at 9:45 a.m.
Yes, and another really exciting thing that we are doing again, as we've been saying, this is Holy Week.
Yes.
Holy Week, this is resurrection season. Gosh, sorry, y'all. It's resurrection season, and we're so excited because we are doing prayer in the tabernacle again this week. It's going to be March 25th through the 28th. We want to make sure you're here. It's from 5 to 7 p.m. And Tuesday, it's going to be a little different. We want to make sure you meet us in the Ministry Activity Center. The MAC is what we call it, from 5 to 7. And you can come in through the globe entrance.
That's right. Now, online family, don't go anywhere. We're coming to see you.
Pastor Chris.
Thank you, guys. We love our Valor students. All right, just a few more things, and then we'll turn you loose. If you missed the opportunity to give earlier in the service, you can do that as you exit today. All of these announcements, all things Resurrection Weekend at whc.life. All right, let's get to serve day, okay? So here's how it's going to work. You're going to pick up your kiddos first, amen? You're going to pick up your kiddos first, and then you're going to go down the hall of faith to the Ministry Activity Center, the MAC, that big glass room, and we have lunch for you ready to go. We're going to eat together as a church family, and then we're going to split up into our different areas and get this place ready to go for Resurrection Weekend, okay? My wife and I will be in here in the tab leading that up, so we look forward to your help. And everywhere, Kid Harvest Clubhouse, all the places, okay? So let's stand, please. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to be in your presence. Lord, we thank you for the food that we're about to receive. Bless it and send the calories to some other church. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'll praise the Lord.
Praise
online
God.
Family. What an amazing service that we just had. Listen, if you're watching right now and you want to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, today, the Bible says that today is the day of salvation.
Yes.
You can pray this quick prayer with me to say, Jesus, come into my heart, save me, forgive me. Amen. And that's it.
It's that easy.
That's right. And make sure that if you prayed that prayer with us, drop a one in the comments and click the link that's there. We want to give you some literature. It's called New Direction, written by our pastor, Dr. Rod Parsley. We help you in this new direction in your walk with Christ.
Yes, make sure that you get that. And hey, those of you watching online, and if someone's commenting on one, make sure you're supporting them and just loving on them, saying we're so proud of you and we're so thankful for you. We also just want to remind you that if you forgot to give your offering or you weren't able to do your giving, you can make sure to do that. It's right there on the screen. We want to give you that opportunity to give.
That's right. And listen, Wednesday nights have been absolutely amazing.
So good.
I know that all of y'all have been tuning in faithfully. So make sure you tune in again this Wednesday at 7 p.m.
Yes. We'll see you there.
Sowing into the kingdom of God has never been easier or more secure than with Smart Giving. Any smartphone will work. To use your Smart Giving, open your text messaging app and send a message to number 45777. In the message of your text, type the amount of your gift, space WHC. If it's your first time giving, you'll receive a secure link to set up your account. Select your home campus, enter your giving method, and where you would like to receive your instant giving receipt. If you already registered, the process is the same. Just send a text message to 45777, type the amount of your gift, space WHC. You'll receive your receipt immediately. If you prefer, you can also sow online at whc.life or by phone or mail. Just call the number on your screen or send your gift to the address displayed.
born in sin and clothed in death, mercy was my plea. Love compelled the heart of God to send grace down to me. Lost in sin, a wretched soul, desperate to be free. Oh, precious one, God's only Son, grace went to Calvary. Grace, powerful grace, grace that restores and rescues me. Grace, powerful grace, I sing the song of the redeemed.